नमस्कार, मैं डॉक्टर राजन सिंह राणा यूसर स्टूडियो में आपका हार्दिक स्वागत करता हूँ। आज यूसर लेक्चर सीरीज के अंतर्गत हमारे बीच हमारे विशेष मेहमान मौजूद हैं, डॉक्टर डीएम पंत। डॉक्टर पंत जी का मैं परिचय देना चाहूँगा। आप एक्स सीनियर साइंटिस्ट एंड प्रोफेसर हैं, इंडियन इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ रिमोट सेंसिंग, इसरो, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ स्पेस, देहरादून। सर, मैं आपका लेक्चर सीरीज के अंतर्गत हार्दिक स्वागत करता हूँ और
थैंक यू।
आज का टॉपिक है हमारा इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ रिमोट सेंसिंग। सर, मैं आपको आमंत्रित करता हूँ।
वेल, गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीबॉडी। टुडे वी विल डिस्कस द इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ रिमोट सेंसिंग, फोटोग्राफी, मैपिंग, एरियल फोटो इंटरप्रिटेशन, सैटेलाइट रिमोट सेंसिंग इन GIS। जस्ट इंट्रोडक्टरी पार्ट, हाउ वी स्टार्ट। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल, रिमोट सेंसिंग, व्हाट इज रिमोट सेंसिंग? सेंसिंग फ्रॉम रिमोट एरिया, हिंदी में इसका मतलब होता है सुदूर संवेदन, मतलब दूर से ही, दूरस्थ से ही उसके बारे में पता करना, दूर से ही किसी के बारे में पहचान करना और उसके बारे में सूचना प्राप्त करना। मैं आपको देख रहा हूँ, आप मुझे देख रहे हैं, ये भी एक तरह की रिमोट सेंसिंग है। अगर मैं आपकी फोटोग्राफी कर रहा हूँ, फोटो ले रहा हूँ और आप मेरी फोटो ले रहा हूँ, ये भी एक रिमोट सेंसिंग है, क्योंकि मैं आपको बिना टच किए हुए, बिना बात किए हुए आपके बारे में, आपके फॉर्म के बारे में पता कर रहा हूँ, किस तरह से आपके अपीयरेंस है, कैसा आपका लिबास है, इसके बारे में सूचना मैं प्राप्त कर रहा हूँ बिना आपको टच किए हुए। तो ये दूरस्थ संवेदन, रिमोट सेंसिंग मतलब दूरस्थ संवेदन, मतलब दूर से ही आपके बारे में पता करना। अब ये क्यों रिमोट सेंसिंग की जरूरत क्यों पड़ी, ये आपको अच्छी तरह से पता है। अगर कोई भी आदमी किसी के बारे में अगर सूचना प्राप्त करना है, किसी के बारे में पता करना है, तो पहले उसकी फोटोग्राफी करेगा, फोटोग्राफी करके उसके बारे में पता करेगा कि किस तरह का आदमी है, कैसा ऑब्जेक्ट है और किस तरह का दिखाई देता है, वो किस तरह का दिखाई देता है, ताकि उसके बारे में अब जहाँ जहाँ जरूरत पड़ेगी, जहाँ जहाँ जरूरत पड़ेगी वहाँ वहाँ हम उसके बारे में बता सकें, उसके फोटो के बारे में, फोटो लेने के बारे में, फोटो याद करके उसके बारे में पता कर सकते भी ये इस तरह का आदमी है, इस तरह का है, इस तरह का ऑब्जेक्ट है, इस तरह का पेड़ है, पौधे है, जमीन, कुछ भी हो उसके बारे में हम पता कर सकते हैं। सो कंसेप्ट, द रिमोट सेंसिंग कंसेप्ट वॉज डेवलप लॉन्ग लॉन्ग बैक। You may say in ancient time it was developed, even in ancient time when the Greek philosopher and mathematician Aristotle developed a pinhole camera. Pinhole camera, उन दिनों में हमारे पास कोई लेंस नहीं था, कोई हेलाइट नहीं थी, केमिकल सब्सटेंस नहीं था। पेनहोल कैमरा में हमने एक बॉक्स में कैमरा बनाया, उसमें होल किया, माइन्यूट होल किया, माइन्यूट होल से सनलाइट को अंदर पेनिट्रेट हुआ बॉक्स के अंदर, और उसमें एक पर्दा, हमने पेपर डाल दिया और उसमें वो इमेज उसकी दिखाई दी, जो भी आपका पेड़ है या कोई आदमी है, कुछ भी हो, उसके अंदर उसका फोटो दिखाई देता है, उसकी अपीयरेंस दिखाई देती थी। उस जमाने में इट इज अ टॉक ऑफ फिफ्थ एंड सिक्स सेंचुरी, पाँचवीं छठी सदी के दरमियान ये चीज़ डेवलप हुई है फोटोग्राफी की, और फोटोग्राफी इज ए कंसेप्ट और रिमोट सेंसिंग। बट द एक्चुअल टर्म रिमोट सेंसिंग केम टू एग्जिस्टेंस ड्यूरिंग 1960s व्हेन द एनआर नासा डेवलप द सैटेलाइट रिमोट सेंसिंग टेक्निक। दे हैव लॉन्च द सैटेलाइट्स, द ऑर्बिट, द आर्टिफिशियल सैटेलाइट, देन दे हैव, दे कुड बी एबल टू गिव द टर्म रिमोट सेंसिंग एट दैट टाइम। द एक्चुअल टर्म वॉज गिवन एट दैट टाइम, but the concept was generated long long back in the ancient time. Now with the passage of time, the camera system was developing, first pinhole camera, then by the time 18th century they have developed a box camera with chemical substances for negative point of view, for negative photograph, for taking the negatives, they have developed the chemical substances, halides, सिल्वर हैलाइड्स, ब्रोमाइड्स, ऑल दोज केमिकल सब्सटेंसेज वे डेवलप एंड थ्रू दोज केमिकल सब्सटेंसेज दे हैव डेवलप्ड द फोटोग्राफी ड्यूरिंग द 16th, 17th, and 18th सेंचुरी. देन ड्यूरिंग द कोर्स ऑफ द 1960s, ड्यूरिंग द कोर्स ऑफ 1960s, द सैटेलाइट रिमोट सेंसिंग टेक्निक वे डेवलप एंड दे हैव टेकन द इमेजेज थ्रू सेटेलाइट थ्रू द सेंसर्स फिक्स ऑन द सेटेलाइट्स, थ्रू द सेंसर फिक्स एट द सेटेलाइट्स. While giving the introduction, we first will start from photography because remote sensing itself gives the impression of the photography. A photograph ground photograph. Then aerial photograph. Mapping. Then satellite remote sensing. Then GIS, geographical information system. So starting the photograph, you will first take the photograph because photograph is the first one which gives the impression of remote sensing. Photograph is the first one which gives you the impression of the remote sensing, sensing from the remote area. Now, what is photograph? Photograph is simply a projection of an object on a plain paper. Through the media is electromagnetic radiation, the light. The projection through light, it gives the impression of the particular object on a particular plain paper. And in through pinhole camera at that time, in ancient time, it was given the impression, and then we have taken the mirror, and through mirror we can get the state object. It was not inverted object, it was a state object at that time. So this photography, so photography, you might have heard in the beginning, the photograph you have to take when you go away from the object, and the objects become appear smaller and smaller, smaller, smaller with the increasing distance. When you come closer and closer, closer, then object will become larger and larger, and it all depends upon the adjustment of your focal length from the object up to the pinhole camera or at the lens. By the time, by with the passage of time, the lens was developed, and lens is a powerful glass which concentrate the focal point and focal length, which adjust the focal point, focal length, and having high intensity, absorb high intensity of light, and that light is focused on the negative, and through negative then you can get the positive camera. And actually what happens? What happens in case of photography? Photography is a perspective projection. Light coming from different objects are coinciding one point, then going to a different direction. The light rays coming from the sun coinciding at a particular object, and particular, that point is a focal point. It coincides at the focal point, center of the lens, then going to a different direction, and it is projected at the negative plane. The depending upon the intensity of the light, the silver halide crystals are displaced on the negative plates. For example, our head is black one. From black, the light, there will be no light at all. So there is no displacement of the silver halides at that particular point, and it appears the darker, it appears the light white one. White, it appears white, not dark, it appears white, because there is no displacement of the chemical substance at that particular place. And with the increasing intensity of the light, then the displacement will be more and more and more, and ultimately you are getting darker, darker, somewhere some gray tones are different, different in different objects. So whatever your appearance, depending on your clothes, depending on your hairs, mouth, everything, shining, all those things, it appears that the displacement of the silver halides in the negative plane. Then the negatives are developed in the positive plane, and you are getting the actual photography of that particular object. In the beginning, we had a black and white photography. There was no development of color photography at that time. So with the passage of time, color photography was developed, and that is more costly. And with the color photography developed with respect to different regions of electromagnetic radiations. We are using the different blue, green and red region of the electromagnetic radiation. By that, we are developing the color photography at that time. So black and white photography, then color photography, color your infrared photography we have taken at that time. As I told you, depending upon the distance of the object from the observer, the photographic, the resolution is also changed with respect to the distance from the observer to the object. Here, in case of your photography, whenever you are taking the photography, we have the curiosity to cover as much as we can, larger the object, more the larger the object, and smaller the scale. And larger the scale, closer the object, the aperture. So we have the curiosity from the very beginning to cover as much as area in a shorter distance. It will always save the time, money, manpower. And we are getting more information in a shorter period. If you are covering more area in a short period, then you are getting more information out of that. We have that curiosity from the very beginning. So that curiosity took us for the satellite remote sensing points of view, for your aerial remote sensing point of view. When we go farther and farther, we are getting more and more, more area within our photographs. So we have had the idea of aerial photographs. In aerial photography, the camera is mounted, fixed at the aircraft at a certain height. And depending upon the height, we are covering the extent of the area. More the height and more the area will be covered, and your scale will be smaller and smaller. It again depends upon your focal length of that particular system, camera system. So aerial photograph, is, you can define it, is a perspective projection. Here, this, for example, this is your lens. Then these are your objects here. So like, it is going like this one, then it is going for the respective direction here. So this particular object will be like this one. So this object, this A, will be registered at A here. This B will be registered at B here, and this C will be registered as here. So the perspective projection, it means here, this one, this entire area will be registered in this way. So because of the perspective projection property of the aerial photograph, it gives you the relative displacement. Relative displacement here, for example, this much of the object you take, this was of the height, this was of the area here. So relieve displacement, it will taken here. This one. And because of this displacement property of the photograph, aerial photograph, we can measure the height of the object in a particular area. If the height may be building, height may be your tree, or height may be any other object, we can measure the height with the respect to this curve. This one, like this one, for example, this is your, here it may be tree. This tree also, just even this one. This tree and this bottom will be rested here. So here the top will be rested here and bottom will be rested in different place. So top and bottom will be rested in two different places. Top and bottom will be rested at two different places. What about the distance between top and bottom occupied on a plain paper, on a flat paper, that will relieve displacement. And there is a certain mechanism by which we can hide. There are three methods of height measurement. There is shadow length method, your relief displacement method, and parallax bar method. We'll discuss this thing later on in detail. These three methods we can measure the height. So first quantity measures we'll take this one. So these photographs, we can have the photography in black and white, we can have the color photography. Now we'll discuss the history of the photography here. In detail we'll be discussing all the history of the photography and emotion in later on in detail one. But here just I'll give the introductory of this one. Photography, aerial photography, history of the photography is also the concept was very, very old. Its concept was very old. And in European country, the concept has been very old. But in India, we have used the aerial photograph for preparing the your maps, topographical maps, after World War II, we have used the photographs, and for taking the photography, we have three companies. Those are CPRU, Air Force Palam, Palam Air Force, and CPRU, Central Photo Reproduction Unit, and CPRU, Palam Airport, Air Survey Company, Dum Dum, that is Calcutta, and Remote Sensing Service Center at Hyderabad, Balanagar, Hyderabad. We have three organizations which are taking the aerial photographs, and out of those three, at the moment, only one agency, one organization is effective, that is, you are still alive, that is your National Remote Sensing Service Center, Balanagar, Hyderabad. So, at the moment, we are taking all the fresh photography from Hyderabad, from National Remote Sensing Service Center, that is Department of Space. And other agencies have been out, their period has been expired, and now we are taking that photography. So, while taking the photograph, whenever we are taking the photograph, we are taking into consideration different specifications of the photographs. The detailed specification and detailed photography we will discuss later on. Here, the specification I just want to tell you, whenever you are going to procure the photograph, you are required to give the specification for a particular project. Like, what you want, what is your objective. Depending upon your objective, you will decide the specification here. What is the scale of the photography, what is the time of the photography, and other qualities, other properties of the photograph will be deciding depending upon your objective. And there are specific features in the photography, area photograph, those are called principal points, the middle one photograph. Principal point. This is principal point, middle of the photograph. Camera, middle of the photograph means nothing but the middle of the camera lens. Then these are called collimating marks, fiducial marks. These are fiducial marks on the photograph. By joining these fiducial marks, we can get the center of the camera photograph. Now here, the specific quality of the photograph is that it is quite unbiased. Photograph is unbiased, aerial photograph also unbiased. Satellite images are unbiased. There is no bias at all. देयर इज नो मैनिपुलेशन, देयर इज नो बायस, सो दिस इज अनबायस वन. सो हियर व्हाई इंटरप्रेटिंग द फोटोग्राफ हियर वी आर रिक्वायर्ड टू हैव द थ्री डायमेंशनल व्यू. 3D इज अ मस्ट. हाउ टू गेट द 3D? वी आर रिक्वायर्ड टू टेक फोटोग्राफी इन अ सच अ वे दैट मोर देन 50% ओवरलैप शुड बी देयर. इफ दिस इज अ पीपी, दिस इज अ पीपी हियर, सो दिस विल बी हैविंग दिस मच ऑफ ओवरलैप हियर, दिस ओवरलैप विल बी हियर. So this was the overlap, and this overlap is a must because we are going to have the fusion between the objects here. What objects are here? The same objects are also here, but these objects were taken from the different camera station, and these are also different camera station. If you are taking your photography from this position and this position, you have this position. There are two positions. If you are going to take your photography from here, then you will be in this fashion. From here, you will be in this fashion. So your position will be slightly changed. And whatever the change of the position, those positions will be fused here when you are getting this fusion image. How to get the fusion image? You have to make a mechanical barrier between two eye retina. You are required to see one object from left side of the left side eye, right side of the left right side, right side object is right side eye. So by seeing these two objects, the identical objects from two different eyes, and we human being has the tendency to concentrate your eyes at a particular point. Conjugate your eyes as a particular point, and there at that particular moment you are getting the fused image. Fused image, as soon as you are getting the fusion of two identical objects, you are getting 3D. 3D means here you are getting height and thickness, your breadth, length and height. Breadth, length and height. All the three objects you will be having. The three in 3D view, and you are getting the fusion with that particular image. So this is regarding photography. The uses of photography we will discuss, and qualitative quantitative interpretation we will discuss later on. And photography, what is photography? We have discussed what is photography. We have discussed now mapping. The ultimate object of satellite remote sensing, aerial remote sensing photography is mapping. Map is an essential tool for execution of the any planning activities. Any kind of planning, we need map. Without map, you cannot proceed on. You cannot plan anything. Map is an essential tool to execute any kind of work, to execute any kind of developmental activities. So, map, what is map? Map is a representation of the object, representation of the Earth. In a flat paper, in a particular scale. It is simply a representation, and through that representation, the scale is there. Smaller the scale, more area will be smaller. Area will be very big, and in a that particular piece of paper, large area will be represented, and your details will be segregated, and the segregated details will be, some of the details will be overlooked, and that way, and in small scale photography, you cannot have a detailed interpretation, detailed mapping, detailed planning at all. But if you are having the large scale photography, in a large scale mapping, where the small area, that particular piece of paper, will get a more detailed information out of that. So, the mapping is the ultimate source, ultimate objective for aerial photography as well photography. As a satellite remote sensing here. So for mapping also we will discuss in detail later on, history of the maps, scale of the maps, etc. Satellite remote sensing. Remote sensing, as I told you, सुदूर संवेदन सेंसिंग फ्रॉम द रिमोट एरिया. रिमोट सेंसिंग इन एक्सेप्शंस इज द साइंस एंड आर्ट ऑफ ऑब्टेनिंग इंफॉर्मेशन अबाउट एन ऑब्जेक्ट और फिनोमिना फ्रॉम अ डिस्टेंस विदाउट एनी फिजिकल टच और कॉन्टैक्ट. द मीडिया इज इलेक्ट्रोमैग्नेटिक रेडिएशन. द लाइट इलेक्ट्रोमैग्नेटिक रेडिएशन दैट मीडिया इज द मोस्ट इम्पोर्टेंट. विदाउट दैट मीडिया इन अ वैक्यूम यू कैन नॉट हैव द दिस काइंड ऑफ कंसेप्ट एट ऑल. देन व्हाइल टॉकिंग द रिमोट सेंसिंग दिस कंसेप्ट हाउ व्हाट इज द कंसेप्ट ऑफ दैट वन. यू नो लाइट कमिंग फ्रॉम द सन इन द फॉर्म ऑफ इलेक्ट्रोमैग्नेटिक रेडिएशन. ए पार्ट ऑफ लाइट इज रिफ्लेक्टेड. इट इज इंसिडेंट ऑन द अर्थ सर्फेस. ए पार्ट ऑफ लाइट इज रिफ्लेक्टेड. ए पार्ट ऑफ लाइट इज रिफ्लेक्टेड. ए पार्ट ऑफ लाइट इज ऑब्जॉर्ब एंड ए पार्ट ऑफ लाइट इज रेडिएटेड बैक टू द एटमॉस्फेयर. आफ्टर ऑब्जॉर्प्शन रेडिएशन टेक्स प्लेस एंड ऑलरेडी दिस इज ए रिफ्लेक्टेंस टेक्स प्लेस. ए रिफ्लेक्टेंस डिपेंड्स अपॉन द सर्फेस करेक्टरिस्टिक ऑफ द ऑब्जेक्ट whereas radiation depends upon the internal molecular and atomic structure of the object. So though after reflectance, after radiation, the light goes in the atmosphere and there are certain atmospheric windows. Some windows are blocked and some windows are allowed to penetrate the light in the atmosphere. The blocked one, the gaseous medium here also. So our satellites are moving day and night at a certain height. Some are at 900 kilometers, some are at 850 kilometers, some are 890 kilometers, like that one. Different kind of satellites are there from different countries. And though there are sensors fixed on the satellites, though after getting incident on the Earth's surface, the light is going in the form of reflectance energy, in the form of the radiated energy. Then it is again incident on the scanning mirror there itself in the sensors. Scan mirror is there. Then after getting incident on those sensor system, those light rays are allowed to pass inside the detector. There are certain detectors for each wavebands. So those detectors, the objective of the detectors is to convert the electromagnetic radiation to electrical impulses. Electrical impulses. Those electrical impulses are correspond to energy variability of the Earth's surface. What about the variability of the energy, variability of the light on the Earth's surface? Those are taken into account, and those electrical impulses are stored in high density digital tapes. Those are itself the satellites, moving in the satellite. Whenever the satellites are passing nearby the Earth station, those signals are passed directly to the ground. Otherwise, those are stored in high density digital tapes there itself. And from high density digital tapes, we are prepared a computer compatible tape, CCT. There is a Earth station in Sahabnagar, Hyderabad. It is about 72 kilometers from Hyderabad. It is 72 kilometers from Hyderabad to that particular place, and day and night work is going on there. So from your high density HDTT, high density digital tape, we are preparing a computer compatible tapes. Those computer compatible tapes are being analyzed digitally and again being prepared in an analog form. And those analog data and digital data is available in NRSC, National Remote Sensing Service Center at Palanagar, Hyderabad, for the user's point of view. So the users, the different users, agriculture department, geology department, mining departments, there are so many such departments, they are taking the data, analyzing the data, and finding the what is what on the earth. Remote sensing encompasses all the degree of dynamics, because whatever the energy variability on the Earth surface, it captures all those energy variability, and those energy variability is being analyzed थ्रू डिजिटल वे, डिजिटल इन द कंप्यूटर एंड थ्रू द एनालॉग फॉर्म, एंड वी आर प्रिपेयरिंग डिफरेंट काइंड ऑफ प्लान्स, डिफरेंट काइंड ऑफ मैप्स, डिफरेंट काइंड ऑफ एक्टिविटीज वी आर टेकिंग टू कंसिडरेशन देयर. सो दिस इज द कंसेप्ट ऑफ द सैटेलाइट रिमोट सेंसिंग, सैटेलाइट रिमोट से आर्टिफिशियल सैटेलाइट रिमोट सेंसिंग. एंड दे ड्यूरिंग द 1960s एंड 70s दिस द कंसेप्ट ऑफ सैटेलाइट रिमोट सेंसिंग वॉज परस्पर्सली इन फुल स्विंग. एंड वेन द नासा, नेशनल एरोनॉटिक्स एंड स्पेस एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन, ये USA अमेरिका, दे हैव लॉन्च दिस, डेवलप द सेटेलाइट, द फर्स्ट ERTS अर्थ रिसोर्स टेक्नोलॉजी सेटेलाइट ERTS-1 वॉज लॉन्च 1972. देन सेकेंड वन लैंडसैट, फर्स्ट लैंडसैट, सेकेंड ERTS-2 दैट इज 1975, देन 1978, देन 1980, सो ऑन. एंड ड्यूरिंग दैट टाइम Department of Space has been purchasing the data by paying certain amount, these millions of rupees, to Americans. And you will be glad to know, today this particular department, this Department of Space, is in a very advanced in the world. We are in fifth position, and instead of purchasing the data, we are selling the data all over the world. We are selling the data, satellite data, all over the world, and we are in a fourth and sixth position. And during 1960s, 70s, this technique, the satellite remote sensing technique, Department of Space Technology, was in a stage of infancy at that time. Now, GIS. Actually, what happens through remote sensing? First of all, I will tell you why remote sensing here in detail. Why remote sensing in detail? You know, there are certain factors required for socio-economic development of the nation. Such factors are like your money, manpower, and your infrastructure, entrepreneurs, there are so many such resources, natural resources, all different kind of scientific aptitudes, technology, all those things are required for the socio-economic development of the nation. For all those, we need the information, prior information. We need the priority. Until unless you have the information in your hand, you cannot proceed on for any kind of developmental activities. You cannot proceed on any kind of developmental until unless you have the information. Satellite remote sensing technique, remote sensing technique is a pioneering to provide you the information in less time, at lower cost, with greater precision of map making, less time, and very less number of manpower. You know, while taking the photograph or while taking the remote sensing data of the very large area in one satellite picture, and the Landsat MSS, first Landsat MSS covers 179 by 179 kilometer in one scene. So we can see that particular area at a glance, and we can correlate one feature to another feature when we are going to analyze the data, when we are going to interpret the data. So that particular scene will take maybe about 15 days, maybe about 10 days for analysis. Without going to the spot, we can tell what is what there is. But I can say that this is not a miracle by which you can tell you all those information in the table itself. We need the sample information from the ground. The sample information we collect from the ground, then come to the laboratory, analyze, interpret the data, and extrapolate the detail for the whole area. Then we can tell what is what in that area. So without going, without having more labor, more manpower, more money, we can give you more information at lesser cost and lesser time. One question. So planning point of view. There are this picture, as I told you, this picture, satellite remote sensing or aerial remote sensing or photography, which are unbiased. Nobody can challenge. If you are going to take your photograph, nobody will challenge. Whatever your appearance, it is there. Whatever your appearance, but if you are going a drawing, if you are going a drawing of a particular object or particular man, then there may be some mistake here or there. Your feature may be deformed, appearance may be deformed. Or you can slightly tilt here, you can make manipulate gesture. But here in case of photography, in case of satellite images, there is no bias at all. Whatever the appearance, whatever the energy is there, whatever variability is there, that is there, nobody can disturb it. That is quite unbiased. And one of the most advantages, again, the third advantage is that it's a multispectral nature. If you are unable to capture a particular information of a particular object in a certain band of the electromagnetic radiation, we can capture the same information another band, third band, fourth band, sixth band. There are so many, because there are innumerous bands, innumerous wavelengths, innumerous frequencies. As and when required, we can take the advantage of all those frequencies, all those band wavelengths. So starting from gamma rays, cosmic rays, then X-ray, then ultraviolet rays, our remote sensing starts from visual point 4. Point 4, it goes to about 3.5, the term. First is a 0.4 to 0.5 is a blue, then 0.5 to 0.6 is a green, 0.6 to 0.7 is a red band, then 0.7 to 3.1 is the infrared. Near infrared, middle infrared, far infrared, then it comes to thermal infrared. Even thermal infrared, it gives you the sensing of the, for example, it depends upon the heat, the temperature of the object, we can sensing the object accordingly in thermal infrared radiation. Then microwaves, 1 millimeter to 1 meter. Then radio waves, longer than 1 kilometer. Those are called radio waves. So our remote sensing starts from 0.4 to 12.5 the Earth. Then GIS, Geographical Information System. Geographical Information System is a very, very powerful computerized tool. It's a very, very powerful computerized tool for collection, storage, analysis, manipulation and retrieval of the data as per the user's requirement. Why this concept has been developed? This was developed by the American geographer, this GIS geographer remote sensing. Yeah? This concept was developed because in the longer run, in the past, we have been preparing so many such kind of maps. And with the passage of time, because of environmental degradation, environmental changes, so those maps were going to change day by day. Today, a particular house was here, tomorrow there was no house, something has come up there. Today, there was forest, after 10 days or 1 month or 2, 6 months, there's agriculture there. Like that one, there are so many changes on the landscape, there has been so many changes in the environment. So, based on the changing of the environmental question, we are required to change the maps, turn the map, and we are with huge loss out of that. So, in order to compensate all those losses, in order to have better planning, the GIS concept has been developed for that multi-layer system. We are preparing the maps as and when required and integrating, analyzing as per the user's requirement. Secondly, those maps, whenever the maps were prepared, we are able to change those maps within the computer, with the digital technique, without much effort. We are changing those maths. We are changing those maths by one click in the computer itself. For example, Jarjar agriculture fields and certain field, that corner of the field, one house has come up, for example. So just one click of the computer, we can just put a house there and just the map was as it is. So there is not much manipulation, manual manipulation, and there has been no effort with respect to time, money and manpower, and as and when required, we can manipulate the map, and based on the suitability of the particular area, we can generate those maps. There are so many such kind of usage of the GIS in a present day's life with the changing circumstances. With the changing circumstances, we are manipulating the maps as and when required through GIS techniques by integration, analysis and modeling point of view. By integrating, analysis, modeling, we can change the maps as per the user's requirement, as per our requirement of planning requirements, as per our developmental requirement. That is your GIS. And this concept was very new, generated about 10-15 years back in USA by the American geographer. Yes. That's all.